the USC School of International Relations last December, and we have those tapes over there. I think Chris Milligan's over there somewhere. Chris, wherever you are. But I issued a bulletin saying that we were on the brink of an economic collapse that would make 1929 look like a picnic. And in the 3 weeks prior to the attacks, the Dow had dropped almost 900 points. Now, what we have seen since then, and you must understand this clearly, is that the Dow's so-called resurrection to close to 10,000 points is strictly the result of a massive infusion of cash from the U.S. Treasury, which is your cash, which is being given to the corporate executives and not to the people who have been laid off. And every time you see the Dow go up, you'd better believe that another 5,000-10,000 people have lost their jobs.
We are also in a global financial crisis that began in 1998 with the collapse of the bond markets and hedge fund derivatives, the money laundering investigations, and the mega mergers in the financial industry. The war buildup after September 11th is now shifting resources from domestic needs to the defense establishment. This fulfills a Bush-Cheney campaign promise to boost defense spending.
But it is not sustainable for a number of reasons. And then this brings us into the issue of oil briefly, and we'll get into this more later. And basically is that oil production in the world is peaking. The last untapped major oil fields in the world are in two places, actually. First, Central Asia, and we'll get into that in depth. And second, guess where? In Colombia. Okay? And this is now a war, and this is now a moment in human history when the age of oil is nearing its end. Because world population and demand... world population and demand will exceed production sometime within roughly the next 10 years. And we're going to get into that for why. But now let's go back into the warnings about September the 11th. And I didn't do a lot of this, and we have time. Osama bin Laden is, of course, a Saudi Arabian by birth. His family is exceptionally wealthy. They own not only major construction companies, but they are heavy investors in high technology stocks like Nortel. They have a piece of Pepsi, I think, and Coca-Cola. They're into everything. They're very wealthy. In 1976, Osama's older brother, Salim bin Laden, hired a man in Texas by the name of Jim Bath, who has CIA connections, to handle all the investments in the United States for the bin Laden family. Jim Bath also happens to be a personal, almost lifelong friend and former Air National Guard pilot with George W. Bush. And immediately after Jim Bath made the arrangements took over the bin Laden family's finances, Jim Bath made a $50,000 investment in George W. Bush's first company, Arbusto Energy. The connections between the Bushes and the bin Ladens become much more clear as you move forward, and we have reported this in From the Wilderness. Again, I was using stories, and you'll see this. When George Herbert Walker Bush made trips to Saudi Arabia in 1998 and 2000 to meet with the Saudi royal family and to meet with the bin Laden family, which he finally acknowledged, along with former British Prime Minister John Major, on behalf of a company called the Carlyle Group, which is the 11th largest defense contractor in the country. Carlyle Group is a privately owned corporation. That means they do not have to report their ownership or financial activities to the SEC. Yet they provide all kinds of the highest technology equipment to the U.S. Pentagon. And Carlyle, of course, has made several, probably billion dollars, and will as a result of this war. In that context, Osama bin Laden went to Afghanistan in 1979, 1980, maybe the early 80s, to fight the Russians, and he was supported by the CIA. And it's interesting to note that when the Russians invaded Afghanistan, 0%, and this is from Professor Alfred McCoy of the University of Wisconsin, who's also one of my subscribers, in a great book called The Politics of Heroin, 0% of the U.S. consumption of heroin came from Pakistan, Afghanistan before the Russian invasion. By 1985, 86, 40% of the heroin in the United States came from that region, all controlled by the Central Intelligence Agency. And Osama bin Laden came up under a guy named Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, who ran six heroin labs, all protected by the CIA and controlled by the agency. He has been a CIA asset for a long period of time. We'll see more about that. He is a CIA creation. Now, we come to September 11th, and we're going to go into a timeline here, and I have written several stories, and I was on the radio here with Sheila Hamilton at KPAM just a few days after the attacks, and I was saying the U.S. government knew these attacks were going to take place and did not stop them. And I keep building to that evidence, but I'm going to show you a couple of things now. Not by any means all of the evidence that I have of foreknowledge, but just a couple of telling points. Israeli security issued urgent warning to CIA of large-scale terror attacks. And this is a long story saying that the Israeli Mossad knew that the attacks were going to take place. They knew that the World Trade Center were the targets. This is from the British paper The Telegraph. Two senior experts with Mossad were sent to Washington in August to alert the CIA, and so on and so forth. This is just one of probably two dozen examples that I have that are absolutely specific. Now, bear in mind that if what I'm showing you is known overtly through the media, how much more does our $30 billion intelligence community know? There's a recurring theme out there that maybe the Israelis did this. You hear that in some right-wing circles. Horse pucky. They didn't do it. They were warning the U.S. hand over fist, and the U.S. did not listen because it needed the attacks. And you will be convinced of that. But here's one of the most telling pieces of evidence that I found. We reviewed the list of former tenants of the World Trade Center at the online Wall Street Journal site, and there's the website. It is an alphabetical list of tenants. Scroll to the very bottom and notice the moving date for the office of Zim American Israeli Shipping to Norfolk, Virginia. They were in the World Trade Center. They must have had Mossad's input because they vacated 1 week before September the 11th, and they broke their lease. The Israelis didn't pull the attack, but they were smart enough to get their people out of the way. How come our government didn't do the same thing for us? Now we're getting into the heart of September the 11th. I picked up this document just a few days after the attacks, September 23rd. And it's from the Herzliya Institute for Counterterrorism. It is an Israeli counterterrorist think tank. Of course it's connected with the Mossad. And what they detailed, this is from the October 15th issue of From the Wilderness. Between September 6th and 7th, the Chicago Board of Options Exchange saw purchases of 4,744 put options on United Airlines and only 396 call options. A put option is basically a bet that the stock price is going to go down. It's a contract that's entered into that's irrevocable. And let's say the gentleman in the suspenders, I do a put option deal with you to sell shares at $100 in 2 weeks, 4 months. 4 months is the standard, but you can write the contract for anything you want. And he's committed now to buy the shares for $100. Well, if I know that the attacks are going to take place, I don't have to deliver the shares until the contract matures. So if I know the stock is going to crash, he enters into a put agreement with me, agrees to buy the shares at $100. The next day the World Trade Center attacks happen, the stocks are selling for $20. I go buy the shares for $20, and he has to buy them for $100. That's how a put option works. That's a short version, okay? So we saw 4,744 put options on United Airlines, but only 396 call options. On September the 10th, 4,516 put options, same deal, were placed on American Airlines, bought on the Chicago Exchange, compared to only 748 calls. There were no other similar trades on any other airlines. And this level of put options was like 600 to 1,200% above normal for United and American Airlines. Now, just these trades alone, there were also put options placed on Merrill Lynch, which had 22 floors. Morgan Stanley had 22 floors, and Merrill Lynch had an offices near. Both were heavily impacted. Heavy put options there, heavy put options on reinsurance companies, Munich Reinsurance, the largest in the world, AXA Reinsurance in France, which owned 25% of American. Totally out of whack. absolutely spiking. There's another newsletter that says very clearly, by a guy by the name of Phil Erlanger, and this is his newsletter, that the insider trading may have cost $1 billion. Now these, just these ones that were identified, produced only $2.5 million in instant profits for somebody who knew the attacks were going to take place. Nobody claimed the profits. The San Francisco Chronicle caught it shortly thereafter, and nobody has claimed them since. And we don't know who made the trades. But what did the Hezliya Institute for Counterterrorism tell us? It told us that the United Airlines put options were placed through the firm A.B. Brown. Do you remember A.B. Brown? A.B. Brown was the firm headed until 1998 by A.B. Buzzy Krongard, who is now the executive director of the Central Intelligence Agency. A.B. Brown was sold in 97 to Bankers Trust, then to Deutsche Bank, I think, in 98 or 99. It was an offshoot of Deutsche Bank. Now, one thing that I know, that I have written heavily about, is that the CIA, the Mossad, and major intelligence services track all stock trading in real time. On my website, you'll see stories about Promise software, and it's very long to go into, but it's a very sophisticated software. I'm going to write the website for you. It's a very sophisticated software that's been mated with artificial intelligence and is capable of integrating wide numbers of databases in different languages. You'll find this on my website at www.copvcia.com. Now, I know that CIA and Mossad track stock trades in real time, so if all these put options were placed on American and United, do you think that should have triggered some alarm inside the Central Intelligence Agency? But instead, we find that the trades were placed through a firm that was once owned, managed, by the guy who was the number three at CIA. This is just pieces of evidence now. I'm building the case. Now, again, we're building up some history here. In January of this year, the Taliban and Al-Qaeda destroyed the entire opium crop in Afghanistan. It's been verified by the United Nations, by the Drug Enforcement Administration, by ABC News, by BBC, who put people on the ground. Afghanistan had been the world's largest producer of opium, producing 70% of the world's heroin. Through the year 2000. In January, they destroyed their crop. Part of it was a price support. They had overproduced the year before, part of it, and they sold from their stockpiles. But there are no opium crops in Afghanistan right now. They've all been planted, of course, since the Bush administration and the CIA have lifted the ban and everybody can go back to work and the CIA can move the heroin again.
Something that is not being reported in the U.S. press, but is getting quite wide coverage in England and in Europe, and that is that the result of our backing the Northern Alliance in Afghanistan this year is to restore a heroin flow which would otherwise have been halved or more in the world, because the Taliban not only announced that they were going to outlaw planting, but their decree worked. There was no Taliban opium planted last year, and that meant a reduction of 90% in the amount of opium coming out of Afghanistan, and the 10% that was left represented a radical increase in the areas under Northern Alliance control. Now, if we had not gone into Afghanistan, this would have been the most effective reduction in the flow of heroin in the world since the DEA was created 30 years ago.